Yeah, no tie this week. We'll talk about it. What's going on, everyone? Seth Miranda here. This is Adorama Rewind, and not so much stuff happened, but there were some cool releases. So let's just jump right into your photo video news. Starting off with Blackmagic, they announced two cameras, mainly for live event type stuff. Let's just go right to it. The Blackmagic announces the Blackmagic Design Studio 4K Pro and 4K Plus. So what exactly are these? Well, it's kind of funny. We actually used the originals of these in the Adorama event space forever. So if you watch Dan Lauren on set from the Adorama store or some of the live events that happened in the Adorama store a while back on Facebook, the original version of these is what we used. So these are live event cameras. They're meant to be used with their ATEM Mini, their ATEM switchers, the live event switcher systems that Blackmagic has been putting out there at a very cost-effective price and pretty easy to use. In fact, I think these are even touchscreen. So the main difference between the 4K Plus and the 4K Pro pretty much is that with the Plus, you get HDMI output, which is ideal for the Mini, the ATEM Mini system, things like that. But if you need SDI or XLR inputs, you're gonna go with the Pro. On top of that, you also get a brighter LCD display. It's an HDR LCD. You get 5-pin talkback and 10G Ethernet IP link. So what this basically is, It's a live event camera, but it's really meant for a multicam type setup. So if, let's say you're someone that only needs HDMI out, you might want to lean more towards the Plus, save the $500 per camera and get multiple cameras and get, you know, I think you get up to 4 inputs on the ATEM Mini. And now you have pretty much a home studio going up or a small production. Really great for what's going on today. A lot of live streaming going on, a lot of self-producing, a lot of DIY productions going on here. Blackmagic has done a great job over the years creating gear that has produced really good results without breaking the bank and allowing a lot of people to get in, a lot of independent studios, a lot of independent filmmakers, a lot of independent, I keep saying independent, but a lot of indie creators out there have been gravitating to Blackmagic design cameras and their switchers mainly because of what you get for the values. Oh, and they are Micro Four Thirds mount. So if you are in that type of system where the lenses are smaller and they're actually really cost effective or more affordable rather, and a lot of filmmakers are, a lot of video people have Micro Four Thirds mount lenses, you're already good to go. So it's pretty cool that they went that route instead of playing some hype game of needing like bigger sensors or whatever. Not that this is unexpected, but it's just kind of cool and it's easier accessibility to just getting your system up and running, right? So we like that kind of stuff. So if you've been looking for something to do a multicam setup or upgrade your live stream, check out Blackmagic. Also look at the ATEM Mini. There's a bunch of different ones and the differences are kind of hard to spot because the gear tends to look the same, but there are noticeable differences in that. So hit me with a comment down below if you are using any of the ATEM Minis. I'm curious to know which one you're using, why, how you use it, and what are you actually doing out there? What are you guys creating? Let me know down there in the comments. For all you people that are using Affinity, boom, there is a big update. Mainly, so they keep calling it a massive update, and I don't know if that's marketing or whatever, but it sounds to me like it's a lot about efficiency, handling more layers, organizing more files. I mean, here alone, they're showing you how you are able to name and organize stacking images for, you know, landscapes and stuff like that, or the ability to use frequency separation a little better if you wanted to do something more with editing skin, which I know half of you guys like just obliterate skin out there on your Instagrams. Shade. No, I'm just kidding. It's pretty cool. It's a great software. A lot of people love it. And now you're just able to upgrade it. So just letting you guys know that there's an update. So go ahead and get that if you're within the Affinity system. I don't know if it's a system so much as it's just like a software package. I don't know. I digress. Another really cool release this week. Tether Tools. Tether Tools does a lot of things. A lot of people associate them with the cables for tethering, obviously, but they've done a lot of grip over the years, but this time they put out a whole system of grip, mainly for speedlight shooters like me. I was actually lucky enough to get a bunch of prototypes from them. Let's jump, I'm getting ahead of myself. Let's go right into it. This is the Adorama site, obviously, but Freo was this cold shoe accessory that existed out there for a while, and I guess they acquired them or whatever, but you're able to now adapt them to all this different grip. This is stuff that allows you to get your speed light anywhere, anytime, to get the shot. And I love this kind of stuff because this alleviates the need to always carry stands. So if you're out there on the street or you're in an environment, if there's like a table, you can clamp down onto a table and use that as your stand. I tend to use chairs a lot because you can actually move chairs around and they're at a decent height for a lot of fill light. Doors are great to clamp onto, pipes, signs, street signs. Everything out there is grippable if you have the grip, and Tether Tools seems to be giving us the ability to do that. So when I said that I got the prototypes, I'm serious. I mean, here it is right here. This is like the big clamp. They actually call it the Grasp Biggie. So it's basically a C-clamp that you can tighten down, and then you have a ball point for your, or ball joint rather, ball point, it's not a pen, that will let you put your speed light however you want. Now, the cool thing about this is it actually has not a lot of footprint in your bag. I mean, look at how narrow that is. It can fold down pretty easily. I'm not trying to sell you on this, guys, but we didn't do a video on it, so I kind of want to clue you into it as best I can while I have the channel and your attention. It's also really cool because it's sort of modular, and I'm not sure if they actually meant it to be, but that's how I'm kind of taking it. You can actually take bits and pieces apart and make things happen. So case in point, right? If you take their articulating arm and you take the piece that is supposed to be kind of like an umbrella adapter, if you put it down onto the arm, let's say I wanna grip something up that's not a speed light, something that has a quarter 20 on the bottom, like a small camera, like you wanna do a remote camera or an action cam or something, you're doing something kind of crazy, whatever it is, quarter 20s are super common and standard in this industry. You take the umbrella adapter, which they actually call the Frio Versatile Baby Pin Adapter Cold Shoe Setup, just rolls off the tongue. Umbrella adapter, and you put it down on the arm, and once you tighten it down, you can then spin the shoe off, and once you spin the shoe off, you expose a quarter 20 thread right there, and you can mount whatever you want. The other thing you can do is, once the thread is exposed, if you want to, you can take the adapter off, and spin it around and actually thread it into the arm. And now what happens is this male 5/8 becomes a female socket, so you don't have to worry about getting like a knuckle or an arm. You can just go right onto a stand. And then you have this other end to grip up whatever you want. They just thought about a lot of different things with it, and I'm really excited about it. I was able to play with it for like the last month or so in secret because, you know, prototypes and stuff like that. But I mean, big clamp, you have small clamps, you can adapt other pieces to it. It's like a fun erector set. And even this thing, which was really cool, you can stick it to glass. Just put it down, pump to create the vacuum, and you can put speed lights all over any type of glass type non-porous surface that can handle a suction cup. Pretty rad. I mean, it's crazy what you can do with speed lights. It's just everything with speed lights is bits and pieces and takes up space in your bag. And until now, a lot of the clamps have been very cumbersome and not pack downable. These are really, really light, have been pretty strong in my short experience so far. So if you're looking for some new, easy, light, and strong grip for speed lights on the fly, check out the Frio collection, all right? I'm yet to put it through like full paces out there. I haven't traveled with it. I'm sure you hear those sirens, Brooklyn. But I am excited to just throw these in my bag and just forget about them and know that I always have grip on me one way or another. And when you're out there on location, every square inch of space in your bag counts. And when you have something that's super versatile, it goes really far. So I know I'm trying to, it sounds like I'm overselling this to death, but as a speed light guy, and as anyone who has followed me on this channel has seen me use speed lights nonstop all over the world, this is like a really cool thing, and I'm super psyched for it. So if you are, let me know down below. If you're a speed light shooter, hit me up. Let me know what you think about this stuff. Let me know what you've been using for grip, because for the last few years, we've finally been getting actual speed light grip. Before then, it was all DIY stuff, and everybody out there who's been a speed light person knows exactly what I'm talking about. Homemade soft boxes, all types of grip. Anyway, let's move on. Let's go into something fun. Leica. Leica's actually putting out something that isn't a camera. They've done stuff like this before, but this one's really interesting. It is a $4,000 collectible. Boom. I don't know why they're calling it a teddy bear. It's not a teddy bear. These are called bear bricks. If you're not familiar with them, they're basically artist collectibles. They come in various sizes, 1,000%, 400%, and 100%, I believe is what they come in. The 1,000% is the $4,000 version of this. These are kind of like art pieces you can collect. It's kind of like production run art, if you think about it. I mean, if you look at it, They've done a lot of things, a lot of collaborations with a lot of artists out there. In fact, this is my buddy L'Amour Supreme, who's a well-known artist here in New York. This is his exclusive limited edition Bear Brick that he did through Mishka. I did a portrait of L'Amour here on the channel. I'll put a link to that video down below. It was actually a really cool shoot. I hope you guys can check it out and leave a comment on that video. But these are limited run. If you're a fan of the artist, you kind of pick these up if you want to support or you want something that can go up in value or be collectible, traded, whatever. It's just like anything else, right? If you guys can get into NFTs, you can get into this. Let's not. But major artists have done collaborations with Bear Brick. I mean, one of the most famous is Kaws, K-A-W-S. If you don't know that one, look it up. This is just kind of cool to see Leica go beyond the idea of a camera company that they are. I always refer to them as like a Rolex, right? Like they're kind of an investment. Even having the original lens cap is a value to the Leica cameras that we have out there. They're also amazing cameras. I know people like totally bust on them and go like, oh, it's a lawyer camera. It's a guy who owns a yacht camera, a dentist camera. But you actually do get a quality camera out of what they're putting out there. The price is a premium. There's something to aspire to. And anyone that's shot a Leica and knows what they're looking at can definitely see there's something special about the files. The Leica glass is incredible. The color space. I don't want to hype them up, but I just think it's super cool to see a brand like Leica transcend beyond just cameras and do something like this. I wonder what other brands could get away with that. Personally, I think somebody like Kodak could probably get away with it because it's just such a phenomenon. It's like such a mainstream icon. Even if you've never been interested in photography seriously, you know Kodak, right? So I'm curious what you guys would think. Who could get away with doing another collectible like this that is a photo brand? Who's got the legacy and the cred to be more about the brand than the actual cameras? Hit me with a comment down below about that. Super, super curious. Let's talk about Nikon for a second. So they have been getting beat up by YouTubers and people all over the place about going out of business or losing profits like that. Well, guess what? They just reported Q1 financial report shows an increase in camera sales and actual profit. This is sad that it's even like kind of like a news thing, but I really do feel like there's a huge phenomenon with negative clickbait, especially on YouTube, for the most popular channels, and they have to feed their machines, I get it. And I'm not gonna throw shade around here, and I don't wanna start any drama here, but rooting for a brand to go under hurts everyone. And I've been hearing about Nikon going out of business or going under or bankrupt or whatever for, it was a year ago, then it was 2 years ago, it was 5 years ago, it was 8 years ago. And then in the same breath, they praise things like the D850 being incredible and stuff like that. I think you guys have to step back and realize that there's headlines and there's actual life and there's millions of people out there that use Nikon. You're looking at me on a Nikon right now, and Daniel Norton goes live with a Nikon all the time on Adorama TV. They're kind of taken off the table as an option for new users based on just how much negativity is out there. This is an upswing, and I'll be honest with you, if I had to put a reason on it, cameras aren't their only business. They aren't. They're in health. They do a lot of stuff in industrial and stuff like that. But if I had to put a reason as to why we're seeing an upswing and things like that, I think it's mainly because one, people are actually using the newer cameras and then liking them. Instead of hearing someone's opinion or bias or whatever, they're going, oh, this is actually pretty rad. I like the glass. I like these features. I like the colors I get out of it. I like the ergonomics. Whatever reason they have for it, they're actually sharing their point of view out there, as opposed to just a one-sided conversation from people who are the only ones who tried the system. Now it's in more people's hands. The other thing is it's evolved, right? A lot of people held out that were in Nikon DSLRs till the 6.2 and the 7.2 came out. Now their big issue is filling supply, right? Nikon's had it tough. They survived the tsunami. They had a factory fire, not to mention COVID, having scarce parts out there, all sorts of things. And keep in mind, they're actually the smallest of the big three companies out there. They just make cameras pretty much. They don't have a printer division. They don't have video game consoles and projectors and other things like that. They really are the smallest of the big three. And it's actually kind of a testament how high they are on the list of brands, given their actual size and that they're not a huge conglomerate. Even though they do other things, they're not really that big, you know what I mean? I always say this, like, kids didn't grow up playing a Nikon PlayStation or getting their book report printed on a Nikon printer. So it's also not as much of a household name. So I know I'm kind of leaning into this a bit, but it's just been incessant seeing the negative, and I think we're all kind of exhausted from it. So my letter to you guys is just stop with the brand bashing. Nobody wins from bashing a brand except the people that want your views. If a brand goes down, you lose an option out there as a consumer. You lose competition in the marketplace. You lose price competitiveness. You lose progression. And people also lose jobs as the industry is already hurting. And then the brands get hurt even more for dumb reasons like this. They lay people off. They restructure a lot. And hundreds, if not thousands, of people lose their jobs. And you see it all the time in headlines. I think you could pull up any brand and someone has talked about laid off to some degree. And there's a lot you can go down with that. But also, pros lose support. So if you're someone that is tens of thousands of dollars invested in a system trying to do your job with lenses, bodies, and whatever else, you lose support, repair, all sorts of things, firmware updates, which also affects consumers. You lose the ability to have the stuff you already bought get upgraded and do more things for you. Everybody loses. There's a lot of things. You lose a different option of point of view, philosophy of how to work with things. They're all just tools, and not every tool is made for you. Some people might like a different version of something else. You know, sensor sizes, all sorts of things. It's just better to have more options than to cheer and root for a brand to go under, honestly. And I think it's enough. Enough is enough. I'm sure you've had enough of me talking about Nikon right now. Let's talk about Sigma for a second. Sigma has been putting out a lot of glass lately, and it's always mainly for E-mount, Sony E-mount, and their L-mount, which goes to Leica, Sigma, and Lumix. All take the same L-mount for full frame. So our own Cooper got a chance to try out this new Sigma Super Zoom 150 to 600 millimeter. Let me go up to the size of this lens right here. That's him in the wilderness of the Bronx Zoo. It's actually pretty rad. You can actually go check him out on our YouTube channel right here. I'll put the link down below, obviously. It's a f5 to 6.3. He wanted to take it on a safari, but it is still troubling times out there. So he went to the Bronx Zoo and shot a bunch of animals with it, but you can see some actual real world use of it if you want to consider the zoo a real world use. I think a lot of people shoot at the zoo and call it wildlife anyway, and it is. You know, you're still capturing moments. You're just not, you know, on the Serengeti or whatever you want to call it. So this has a lot of cool features, one being the optical stabilization. This isn't really a new thing that it has two modes, but one of the modes is mainly for panning. So if you're someone that uses like a monopod and you pan a lot for like car racing or sports, it actually has an optical stabilization mode for that. And remember, the longer the lens, the more exaggerated the shake becomes. So any stabilization boost you can get, take it, okay? Take it and run. But really, it's pretty cool, and it's at a cost-effective price. So if you're someone that's been wanting a very versatile super zoom out there, or someone that's getting into sports and wants to try out lenses with that much focal length, you're talking about a 150 to 600 millimeter for a pretty affordable price of $1,500. I think that's pretty good, considering that, you know, a 600 millimeter f4 would cost someone, you know, 20 grand. You can get a 600 millimeter that, yes, is variable aperture, but it's 6.3, and you get the zoom and the stabilization, all that for 1500 bucks. It's a win-win. Check out the image quality for yourself in the video. Listen to his first impressions, whatever you want to call it, in the video. Just take a look at that. Speaking of the YouTube channel, let's talk about some things that went down this week. Pi Jerza, he did what is mixed lighting and how to fix it. So go check out his series, Master Your Craft. He walks you through what he does on jobs. Man, my English, guys. You should just yell at me in the comments about my English. On jobs when he has to deal with mixed lighting, you know, daylight mixed with candlelight in some hall for a wedding, or, you know, sodium vapor mixed with LED and all sorts of stuff that's going on out there. So if you're someone that's been shooting on locations and have to deal with a lot of different temperature of light, style of light, frequency, flicker rates, all sorts of stuff, go check out his video, and the rest of his series is really phenomenal. Go check him out. And also, there's a ton of other stuff that's been going on with the channel. Remember, there's like probably at least one video a day, I'm gonna say, going on, including Daniel Norton going live every other week. And sometimes I'm there with him, but you can check out him shooting lighting on the fly. This is masculine versus feminine. He's showing you what he would do for different faces. He shot Dave Bruska, if you guys remember him. He used to be all over the channel. Well, he came and hung out. He shot our model Farah, who is lovely in her own right. and just put them together and shot them separately and showed different types of light. So go check that out. This is a live demo, so it does run a little longer, but in the end, I think live is always the way to go. You're seeing solutions on the fly, and you're also able to ask questions, and we adapt and do it on the spot. I feel like we get these comments of, what happened between the shot and what you just showed me? There's something in between. Well, now you're seeing everything, every step from A to Z, except for editing, which Daniel doesn't really edit anyway. What he shoots is what you get, kind of like the way I do it. All right, and as far as other things you'll be checking out on Adorama, don't forget the Twitch channel. I know I'm like super pushy of this, but I think you guys should totally check it out. There's a lot of things going on, including Sunday night, 7 p.m. There's always something going on. And one of those things is the Sunday show with me and Josh. So if you check it out here, we get into all the gaming news that's fit to print. We just talk about everything that's going on in the industry. If you guys want to give us your point of view, your opinions, want us to check something out, talk about something, we talk about the progression of the technology, the games coming out, what we like. We definitely go on tangents. We've definitely gone down some like weird eBay rabbit holes of looking for weird gaming stuff. And we just talk about things that are going on, especially with PC gaming, consoles, and anything in between. So come join us on Sunday, 7 p.m. The weeks that we're not there, there's always a gaming tournament or Daniel doing Dungeons & Dragons. So 7 p.m. Eastern time, go to Adorama XP on Twitch and come hang out. And along with that is, of course, what I shout out last week, which is our Discord. And I'm seeing a lot of new faces. Not really, I'm not seeing a lot of new faces. But I'm seeing a lot of new screen names pop up on the Discord after last week's Rewind. So if you're new to it, come jump in. We have rooms for everything, including all the gaming consoles, PC builds, if you want to share your PC build, as well as share your images from whatever cameras you're shooting with. There is a room for everybody. Canon, Nikon, Sony, Lumix, Leica, Pentax, even Olympus. You Olympus people, come. I will be your refuge. Come hang out. And just ask questions. If you guys have any issues with something, we're all there. Adorama hosts are sometimes in there as well as the Twitch host, Ab Cisse, who is the man as far as lighting and just showing you guys how to do proper editing and just an awesome personality. He's in there. Data Dave, Raquel Lilly, if you want to ask any music type questions. Celtis for digital illustration. I have my own room if you want to yell at me there, knock yourself out. Josh, everybody has something going on in the Discord. Okay, and shout out of the week. I said I was gonna keep it going. Well, shout out of the week goes to our boy, I'm sorry if I pronounced your name wrong, Alcindair Toms. He's been super active and is a real hardcore working photographer out there trying to grow his client list. So check out his work. He's always sharing it in the Discord. He's been sharing it live and tweeting it at Adorama and stuff like that. So do me a favor, go check out his page and hit follow on him. He's a good guy and he definitely has good insight to what he's trying to do, growing his business, growing his craft, and maybe you're in the same position he's in. So it's kind of nice to keep it communal that way. And if you guys want to get into a shout out of the week, let me know what your Instagram is down below. Stay away from private URLs. There were some issues in the past with stuff like that. So they'll find your website through your Instagram or Twitter or whatever social. Just stick to social tags and I'll see what's up and I'll try to share someone, at least one person every week. Let's keep this communal. Don't forget you guys can reply to each other in the comments. It's not just speaking to a void. Maybe you guys can share point of views or give someone a different side of things that they might not be understanding with what they're commenting. Keep it civil, no malice, and let's just be real communal down there. For question of the week, I'm going to go throw it back to the Leica thing. What's a photo collectible you would want that's not exactly a photo gear related? You know, what's something that you would want that you can call a collectible for a brand? I don't know if you want to call it like a camera strap or something like that, but you know, I remember there used to be coins that Nikon gave out for their 100th anniversary. I think I have one somewhere, or I actually have a jelly bean that's individually wrapped. I think it's a Canon jelly bean and it has a logo on it. I don't know, I save weird things from trade shows. But what's something you guys would want? Would you want, you know, I think it would be super funny if someone did a Beanie Baby because no one cares about those anymore. What's something collectible that's out there? You know what would be kind of cool? What about they did trading cards for pros, the ambassadors for the pro? A Joe McNally trading card would be bananas. I think that'd be sick. Some stats on the back, you know, a quote maybe. I don't know, maybe I'm crazy, maybe, I don't know, you tell me. What's a collectible you'd want? I'm running this way too long. Once again, I apologize. All right, and as far as the tie thing goes, if you guys want me to bring that whole thing back and start dressing like, I don't know, civil, I guess, or civilized, I'm gonna need something from you. So let's try to get the like count to a certain number. I'm trying to think of one. Let's do an homage to Polaroid. So if we break 669 likes, I will bring back wearing a tie and I will dress up for you guys, okay? So, well, I can't believe. But hey, I loved 669 film, and if anyone does transfers knows what that film was all about, and I miss it so much. I have a memorial to a tattoo on my thigh. That's how much I miss that film. Anyway, we break 669 likes. I will bring back wearing a shirt and tie and all that kind of stuff. So let's see if we can make that happen. But for now, share this video around, hit subscribe, plus the bell to get notified more videos like this come out. And comments, don't forget, if you're not seeing Adderall videos getting served up to you, you need to engage. So that means likes and dropping a comment, even if it's just like a period or an emoji or something. It lets YouTube know that you liked or are into this channel, and more of the videos will be popped up in your face when they are uploaded or posted or whatever you want to call it. Okay, my name is Seth Miranda, Last X Witness on all social. Yell at me on Twitter, check out my work on Instagram, join me on Twitch, blah, 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 blah. I'll see you next time. Later, guys. Peace.